Time that there is at your head over there. This is Demola Oyele welcoming you to another episode of Leaders Arise. Leaders Arise is a platform where we're going to teach leadership in a very practical way, helping you to maximize your life and maximize whatever it is you do. And I do hope that this, our time together, will be productive, will be engaging, will be exciting, and will be rewarding. Welcome again to this episode. I'm sure that you are going to be inspired. And of course, your life and whatever it is you do will not remain the same. Today, very quickly, I want to dissect the concept of influence. Did you get what I just said? Now, I want to dissect the concept of influence. You want to call it the anatomy of influence. The anatomy of influence. Forget about the grammar, okay? I just want you to know that I want to dissect influence. Because over the years, over time, leadership has been defined as influence. That statement was often credited to John Maxwell, but obviously, you should have known by now that it was not John Maxwell's statement, but he popularized that statement. Leadership is influence. Like John Maxwell used to say, nothing more, nothing less. All right. So he was just trying to help us to explain leadership in its simplest form, purest form. And that statement is as valid today as it was several years ago when it was first made. But today, my job is simple, maybe not too simple, but I'm sure we are going to gain a lot from what I'm about to share. My job is relatively simple, and the job is to help you to dissect influence. So you want to call it the anatomy of influence. So what is influence really? Alright, what is influence? Alright, influence is the ability or capacity to determine the way something or someone turns out. Did you get what I just said now? Influence, simply put, is the ability or capacity, all right, to determine the way something or someone turns out. All right? Maybe you want to say, influence is the ability or capacity to determine outcome. So when we say leadership is influence, we are actually saying that a leader has the capacity or should have the capacity or the ability to determine, all right, the way something or someone turns out. And this definition has opened us up to two things. Number one, things or people. Because I've shared over time that not everybody will influence people directly. Did you get what I just said now? Not everybody will influence people directly. Because when we talk about leadership, you know, some people are quick to say, I'm not a people person, so I can't be a leader. Or me, I don't like to face people. And you know, some people have been pushed. I said, go and face crowd. If you call yourself a leader, you must be able to talk. Alright, you must be able to talk, you must be fluent, you must be vocal, you must be able to talk, you must be able to win the heart of people by your speech and all of that. And there could be somebody watching me right now that, oh boy, you've tried that for years. You didn't know they work. It doesn't just work. You try to talk. And in your process of being to try to talk, all right, you have mistalked. All right, you have mistalked that you're even blaming yourself. Now, don't get me wrong, leaders should be able to talk, at least. But understand that leadership is not about people alone, it's about things also. So the ability to influence, or let me use the word, the ability to determine the way something or someone turns out is what we call leadership. So some of us are not going to impact or influence people directly, but obviously we are going to influence people indirectly. So the end product of leadership is impacting lives, impacting people. That's the end product. While some of us are going to impact people, all right, or determine people's outcome directly. Like as I'm engaging you on this platform, I'm being watched by quite a number of people, all right, so I'm impacting or influencing them directly. But not everybody will be able to do what I'm doing, not because they are failures, not because they are not serious or they are not sound, not because they are not intelligent, but because the way they will deploy their leadership will be different from mine. And I think that will deliver somebody from this idea that if I don't know how to talk, then I don't think I'll be a leader. If I don't know how to do this one, if I can't talk like Pastor Demola, if I can't talk like Bishop this, if I don't can't talk like Barack Obama, if I cannot talk and all of that, that means I'm not a leader. No. In fact, some of us are best fitted, all right, for platforms that will not directly relate with people. Take a look at the scientists, maybe those who are trying to help us find cure for COVID-19. I can imagine hours they spend in the laboratory. All right. They are not in a conference room addressing millions of people like other leaders are doing. They are not even on Facebook as I'm teaching now, but they are lost somewhere in the laboratory. Alright, trying to mix stuff together, trying to perform some experiments, alright, trying to discover cure for this, cure for that, trying to manufacture things like that. But do you want to tell me they are not leaders? They are leaders. Why? Because they are determining the way something will turn out. They are mixing reagents together. That's what they call it in chemistry or biology or whatever, or science. They are adding this to that. They are leaders because they are determining outcome. And don't forget, the end product of their laboratory work will be to impact people, albeit not directly. All right. So everybody will lead, or everybody's a leader. All right. Meaning that everybody's a person of influence. All right. But listen to me, influence is not only directed towards people, influence is also directed towards things. But the end product of our influence, either on things or on people, the end product must be to impact lives. Now don't forget, I'm talking about the anatomy of influence. And the first thing I've tried to do today is to explain or define what influence really is. Can I say very quickly today, everybody is an influencer. In fact, God created every human being with the capacity to influence. So why do we say everybody is a leader? We are saying everybody is a leader because inherent in every human being is a capacity to influence. Did you get what I just said? No. It's a capacity to influence. In fact, God knows that we are people of influence, or man is a creation of influence, or creature of influence. That God said, guy, man, take over the earth. Me, I will take over the heaven. I will leave you there. Can you imagine? That's influence. God believes so much in man. The book of Psalms says the heavens are the Lord's, but the earth he has given to the sons of men. That means that God knows that fundamentally man is a creature of influence. Alright, so I will create the heaven and the earth. I will manage the earth, which is the headquarter of my operation. I will hand over the branch, okay, of my operation, which is the earth. I will hand it over to man so that man can influence the earth. And on the earth, you have people, other men. On the earth, you have things. So God expects that when I put man on the earth, man will determine the way the earth will turn out. I don't want to go into the argument whether man is making the earth to turn out the way God originally plans, but you and I know that man has done a lot. Am I correct? Man has done a lot. You are watching me right now because of what man has done. Somebody invented this gadget and this platform, or right, via which I'm reaching you. I don't know what part of the world you are streaming this video from. That's influence. That's influence. That's influence. That is somebody rising up to his leadership capacity, determining how things will turn out. Like he must have had before now that, all right, when God created the heaven and the earth, one of the reasons that God didn't finish the creation. But I'll balance it by saying that God created the basics. And he said, man, create other ones. God created oranges, trees, and all of that. But God didn't create orange juice. Amen. That was man. Amen. That was man. God created the hair, but God didn't create network. God didn't create radio waves and all of that. So it was man. But what God actually created was raw material. Raw material of hair. The hair will breathe in and out, but man looked at it and said, beyond just breathing in and out, the hair that God created, we can do something with it. Alright? We can cause some signals to pass through hair as a channel. And of course, you can imagine other things that man has created. That was influence. Determining how something or someone turns out. So I want to speak to everyone today that is connected to this broadcast. You are a leader because you are a person of influence. The original man is a creature of influence. All right, is a creature of influence. God created man with the capacity to influence. And I want to tell you today that God has created you with the capacity to influence. Either you influence things or influence people. Some of us will not influence people directly. We influence things. We influence stuff that are inanimate. But indirectly, those things will influence other people. Or we influence people. Did you get what I just said? So that is influence. The ability to determine the way something or someone behaves. Now, even talking about people influence or influencing people. You know, experts have shown to us that even the most introverted person on the earth influences minimum of 6,000 people in his lifetime or a lifetime. Can you imagine the capacity for influence? That means a person that we feel that is an indoor person, is an inward person, all right, is a reserved person, he doesn't talk too much. I don't think I'm the most introverted person on the earth. And I don't think you are also. I don't know who the most introverted person is. But experts have shown to us, or studies have shown to us, that even that person that is the most introverted person will influence minimum of 6,000 people in his lifetime. Can you imagine that? 6,000! That you and I get before God in heaven, and God says your life impacted 6,000 people. I think that's not too bad. That's not too bad. Whereas some people, their life will influence 60 million people. Can you imagine? There are some celebrities in our world today that their followers on Instagram alone is in tens of millions. That any post they put on social media or whatever is being viewed by tens of millions of people. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? That is influence. But I don't want you to be discouraged about the fact that your Facebook page or your Instagram page, you only have 12 followers, you only have 500 followers. That's not my emphasis today. My emphasis is that it's not a function of all of those. The inherent to you is the capacity to influence minimum of 6,000 people. That is even for the most introverted person. The person we can say that is not influencing people, he's really inventing things. But in his or her lifetime, he or she will be able to influence minimum of 6,000 people in his lifetime. Don't forget, we are talking about the anatomy of influence, and this is leaders arise. All right, and we're going to continue very shortly from where I've stopped now. I wanted to take time. The next 30 seconds, just absorb what you have learned. All right, absorb what you've learned. Leadership is influence. Ability to determine the way something or someone behaves or turns out. Now, very quickly as we continue. So when we talk about influence, let's push it further. The first law of influence, as far as leadership is concerned, number one, is to understand that you are a creature of influence. Because you can be influencing things or people and you don't know. You don't know. In fact, I think that is where a lot of us need to pay attention to. That whether you realize it or not, you are already influencing people and things. Whether you realize it or not. Whether you realize it or not. In fact, without talking, you are influencing people without knowing. Your actions and inactions is having one form of influence on the other of people. Your sigh. You're sitting down dejected, God forbid, is influencing somebody. Your smile is influencing somebody. Your punctuality to your place of work is influencing somebody. Your dress sense is influencing somebody. Your dedication to your studies as a student is influencing somebody. Your sacrifice you are giving to the work of God as a pastor is influencing somebody. Your coming to church early as a church member is influencing somebody. Maybe I should quickly emphasize today that you should start watching out for the not so bogus things you do that influence people. In fact, a wise man once said, leadership is most potent when it is silent. Did you say what I just said now? Leadership is most what? Potent when it is silent. So start watching out for the not so bogus, not so popular, not so conspicuous things that you do or do not do that influences people. Yeah. Start paying attention. If somebody ever tells you that the way you dress is influencing somebody, wouldn't you want to take charge of your dress life? If somebody ever tells you that the way you handle your work as an employee in a company is already affecting other employees in the same organization, won't you want to do more of that? If somebody ever tells you that your punctuality to church as a church member is an encouragement to the pastor, encouragement to other members of the church, won't you want to do that or do more of that? As a mother at all, if somebody ever tells you that you kneel down every morning, every night to pray, your son or your daughter is already being influenced by that dedication to God without you preaching the message to him or her, wouldn't you want to do more of that? So the first thought I want to share with you today as I begin to round up on the subject of the anatomy of influence is the fact that you are already influencing people whether you know it or not. You're already influencing people, you're already influencing things, because man is intrinsically a creature of influence. Did you get what I just said? Now, I want to quickly say this, which is the high point of my discussion today, that as much as I believe that leadership is influence, but not all influence translates to genuine leadership. Did you get what I just said? Because I think we have belabored, whatever you want to call it, this sort of influence. But influence does not automatically translate to leadership or genuine or effective leadership. Maybe I need to tell you that having understood that you are a creature of influence, then you need to ask yourself, how is my influence like? And in that way, I want to talk about, is my influence positive or negative? Yeah? Is my influence positive or negative? You don't want to get to heaven and God begins to show you how your influence has impacted people negatively. Yeah. Or you don't want people to come to the end of the year or whatever it is you do and people begin to give a record or a report of your life and they are telling you how your life has impacted them negatively. So number two, you've got to ask yourself, what is the direction of my influence? Did you get what I said? Is my influence positive? Is my influence negative? So if your influence is negative, obviously you have got to redirect it. Yeah. If you go late to your place of work and somebody is already you're taking a cue from that, you're influencing that person negatively, you've got to stop. You've got to stop. If you're a cantankerous person in a church or a place of work that people begin to use you as a model as to how life will go, you've got to stop. If you are a husband at home that talks anyhow, that stays late at night or do stuff that is not worthy of emulation, and your children are already taking a cue from that, you've got to understand that that influence is not positive. So once you discover the nature of your influence, in this case negative, you've got to change and redirect it. Because influence must be channeled correctly. Did you get what I just said? Alright, so if your influence is positive, then you've got to grow it. Alright? Number one, I said, know that you are a creature of influence. Number two, discover what type of influence you are having, negative or positive. Number three, or number 2B, if you want to say, if it is positive, change it and redirect it to something positive. Then number 3 point now, once you know that your influence is positive, then grow it. What does that mean? Do more of the things that affect people positively. Now, if for instance, now I know that this broadcast Leaders Arise is affecting you positively, that's a measure of influence. All I've got to do is to do more of this. All right? To do more of this. The last broadcast, the first maiden edition of this broadcast we had, within 3 hours, we have over 250 views already. Within 3 hours. If I'm less than 2 hours, we're already counting over 200. All right? I don't know what the views are today. Now, that tells me, of course, it may not be all the viewers are engaged completely with the broadcast, but at least it reached minimum of 270 or thereabout within 3 hours. I don't know what the number of views are. So I know that this one is already influencing or affecting people positively. I've got quite a number of feedbacks. So I want to do more of that. So how do you grow your influence? Do more of that. Do more of the things that influences people negatively, positively. How do you grow your influence? Learn more. Yeah, learn more. That's why the greatest room in the world is a room for improvement. The largest room in the world is a room for improvement. That's why leaders are learners. The day you stop learning, you start dying. Leaders are learners. Leaders are learners. So learn more. I'm doing this broadcast today. This is not my best. I will learn more. Because the problem with most people is that once they discover that their influence is impacting people positively, they just go and sleep. They never understood that the more you're influencing people positively, you've got to grow that influence. And you don't grow that influence by chance. You grow that influence by doing more of it. Then most importantly, you grow that influence by learning more. You learn more. Did you get what I just said? You learn more. When you learn more, you grow that influence. You multiply that influence. The influence goes beyond the small region that it is presently in, then it begins to go all over the places. All over the places. You do it better than you have done it before. You do it better than you have done it before. You do more of it. You are conscious of it. All right. The number 4 things to do very quickly, all right, is to learn to convert your influence to impact. I'm going to be rounding up on that shortly. So learn to convert your what? Influence to impact. Yeah, because not every influence translates to impact. Yeah. Not every influence does what? Translates to impact. But you cannot impact people without influencing them. But you can influence them without impacting them. So what does it mean to impact people? It means that whatever it is you do causes a significant change in their lives. It means that you use your power of influence to cause a shift, a major one for that matter, in their lives. Yeah. And that's why our slogan in our work, one of our statements, is raising men of lasting impact. Impact. Lasting impact. So it suffices to say that you've got to work on your influence, that it becomes impact, but it does not just become impact, the impact must be lasting. Are you following me today? Yeah, the impact must be lasting. Yeah, the impact must be lasting, it must be continuous. And that's why every leader must learn this principle. One of the most important statements in the Word of God, the Holy Bible, is the word continue. Somebody say continue. Say, Pastor, are you preaching? Don't mind me, I'm used to speaking like this on the pulpit.
Continue. You want to make a lasting impact? Continue. The future does not belong to those who just do something for a while and stops. No wonder Jesus said in John 8:31, he said, if you obey my word, or if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples. Then you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So it's not enough to start. It is important you continue. Continue. I want to ask you today, what is that significant positive thing you have done with your life this year? Why not continue? Yeah. So they're posting on social media, people are getting blessed. Why not continue? Yeah, continue. You started that business, why not continue? Because if you do not continue, number one, your influence will wane. Number two, your impact will disappear. But if you continue at whatever positive thing you are doing, your influence grows. There is nothing like overnight success. Anybody you see today that seems to be a juggernaut today, they continue at whatever it is they do. They continue. And I think I want to emphasize that to somebody here today, continue. Particularly when you understand that what you are doing is positive, what you are doing is influencing people and bringing glory to God, you've got to continue. Continue that business, continue that mentorship, continue that punctuality to your place of work or to your place of worship, continue that philanthropism that you're doing, continue. Yeah, continue. Because it is not enough to have influence, it is important your influence translate to impact. But most importantly, your impact must be lasting. Yeah. In fact, I normally say it this way, it's a good way to wrap up today's broadcast, that your impact must be global, must be eternal, must be generational. You can see we have a long way to go. In case you are still trying to drag your feet, brother, sister, you have a long way to go. I know you are impacting your local government. I say congratulations. But your destiny is a destiny that is global, that is generational, that must be eternal. We are supposed to be an eternal excellency, the joy of many generations. You are not just supposed to be a one generation wonder. You are supposed to be an eternal excellence, the joy of many generations. So every leader must have this mindset. I am not just supposed to be an influence on people alone. My influence must translate to impact. And my impact must be lasting. And what will make my impact to be lasting is that I must continue, I must grow it. So don't forget those three things. Your impact must be global, your impact must be generational, and your impact must be eternal. So if you and I will measure our life that way, we will discover that we have a long way to go. Yeah, we have a long way to go. Global. And let me say this very quickly. If you want your impact to be global, you must have a global mindset. Yeah. You must have a global mindset. You must do whatever it is you do with a high on the wall, not your local government. I remember when I was writing my first book, I told myself in 2010, I must put my best into this book. Little did I know that the first month or thereabout that the book was published and released, my book got to the US. My professor those days on campus said, Demola, my son is traveling out of the country for his graduate study. Can I have 50 copies of the book? He bought them from me and he gave it to his son. And he said, son, when you get to America, distribute this book to folks over there. So within 3 weeks of publishing, my book got to America. But can you imagine if I wrote that book with a Nigerian mindset? Quite all right, the book will get to America. God forbid, it will be lost in America. Or maybe when my professor said, Demola, can I have 50 copies to take to my to give my son to take to America? I would have put my hands on my head and say, well, if I had known, I would have put more excellence into what I'm doing. I've got to put excellence into it. So you want to sing with excellence. You are working for one primary school, one public primary school. why not carry yourself as though you are working for the best school in the world? That in case you have an opening to travel out of the country to be a teacher in UK, teacher in Germany or wherever, you will have developed a global mindset that your influence and impact in Nigeria is transportable to over there abroad. Did you get what I just said? So your impact must be global. Yeah? Must be generational. I'm going to stop there today. Just three things. Your impact must be what? Global, and it begins with having a global mindset, putting an excellent touch into whatever you do, not minding your location, not minding your background, but putting excellence, global mindset in whatever you do. Give it your best. In one of our episodes on this platform, I'll still teach you about excellence. Because excellence is simply giving your best. It doesn't mean perfection. Excellence means improvement. Giving the best that you need to give. So it must be global, it must be generational. That means that whatever you do must be able to go beyond your generation. Because you have been called an eternal excellency, the joy of many generations. So you start a business, don't think about your generation alone. Can my son, my grandson, my great-grandson, my great-great-great-great-grandson, can he come and meet this business and work with this business? In John chapter 4, verse 12 or verse 20 or thereabout, the woman at the well of Samaria or thereabout approached Jesus or confronted Jesus. He said, are you greater than our father's Jacob? Father Jacob, who dug this well and he drank from it, and his children and his sons and his cattle drank from it. So what that man, woman seemed to be telling Jesus was that we have a father Jacob who made generational impact. He dug a well 400 years ago before the time of Jesus, and he drank from it. All right, his children, his cattle drank from it, and after 400 years Jesus still came back to drink from the same well. And that well must be deep. And I want to ask you, are you digging a deep well in that business, in that career, in that ministry, in that your family? Are you digging deep enough? The well of your destiny, so that generations to come can still drink from that well. Don't be shallow, be deep. Because it's deep people that can be generation. You don't want our generation to fetch you dry. That they keep fetching you and you keep getting fresh. That when you are gone, the well is still standing and people are drinking from the well. And of course, your impact must be eternal. Meaning that it should be able to cross to the other side of eternity. Because there are some people that once they are done here on the earth, ever forget their lives. But we want to live a life that when we are done here on the earth, our work still speaks for us over there in heaven. And that comes by accepting Jesus into your life and as your Lord and Savior, and following after God and doing the will of God. Because it is what whoever does the will of God that will abide forever. So our leadership must be used to advance the purposes of God, without which our impact will not be eternal. I trust that you have learned something from today's episode. The anatomy of influence and making impact out of influence, and ensuring that your impact is lasting, meaning global, generational, and eternal. I pray that this will be your lot. God bless you. Thank you for joining me today on this episode. I hope to connect with you again another time. I believe that you have been so inspired, all right, by this episode. I encourage you and let me have your feedbacks. In case you have questions you want to ask, you can type it on the comment box or reach me personally on my contact detail scrolling on the screen right now. Help me share this broadcast to your network and let as many people as possible get to see it. And be blessed. Till I meet you with you again on the next episode of Leaders Arise, keep on manifesting your leadership destiny. I am Bimola Awuyele. God bless you. Have a great time. See you again. Bye for now.